Hello and welcome to Rally Report on this, the third day of the Lombard RAC Rally. And even as we come on the air, the backmarkers are still pulling into the Parc Fermé in Carlisle after a long, hard day's work in the Lake District and the giant forest of Kielder in Northamptonshire. 92 stage miles in all, there are no easy days on this rally, and it's been at or below freezing all day, so ice has been a major factor. Torval and Dean Country, as one driver put it. We pick up the story in Grisdale. The first stage there is one of the longest and toughest of the entire rally, full of difficult bends. The second is shorter and faster. Barrie Gill.
Marco Wallen was aiming for a record 19th championship win as he led 131 survivors into the Grisdale stage near Ambleside. He emerged with a near 5-minute lead. Bjorn Voldegard, winner here in 1977, wasn't so lucky. Only 6 miles into the first 17-mile stage, he had a puncture and had to drive the rest of the stage with a flat front nearside tyre. Timo Salonen was enjoying an all-Mazda duel with his distinguished teammate Mikkola. Here he had to give best to the four times winner, dropping from third to fourth place overall. The new Mazda achieved its first victory of the season in Australia earlier this month, but the team are still looking for their first European victory. Mikkola's form in the forest certainly raised their hopes. Pentti Urikkala was a puncture victim just 3 miles into the first stage. He had to stop and change the tyre, which cost him some 3 minutes. He was only 58th fastest and dropped down to sixth place. Juha Kankkonen was second fastest on the first Grisdale stage and tied with the lane on the second to overhaul Urikkala and take fifth place. German champion Armin Schwartz continued to impress. Third fastest through Grisdale, he comfortably held on to his seventh place. Stig Blomqvist, eighth overnight, was not happy about the conditions. Still the leading Ford, he dropped to ninth place at the end of the Grisdale test. The 1984 winner Ari Vatanen was much happier today with his revolutionary Mitsubishi. He was fourth fastest on both stages in Grisdale and advanced up the leaderboard to eighth position. Cumbrian Malcolm Wilson, despite a far disadvantage, was the fastest of the two-wheel drive cars on both the Grisdale stages, maintaining his 10th position. Welshman David Llewellyn was 13th overall after his home stages. And despite nudging a banking in Grisdale, he held on to this place, chasing hard after Sainz. The highest placed Group N car was Massimo Ercolani's Lancia, 14th overall this morning. But in Grisdale, the man from San Marino hit a log pile, damaging his rear suspension and axle. He somehow managed to crab his way through the stage, 121st fastest, and dropped to 42nd overall. Spaniard Carlos Sainz was another Grisdale victim. He spun backwards into the trees, damaging his Sierra, and could only manage 21st fastest time. Louise Aitken-Walker was still in the top 20, in 19th place. But that place was threatened by this incident seen by the in-car camera in Grisdale.
Well, all the trouble and strife in the Welsh Forest yesterday had sliced the field down to 131 cars at the start today. The ice in Grisdale picked off six more. So at under the halfway stage in this rally, fully a third of the runners had fallen by the wayside. Now, the redoubtable Tony Mason, whom I incorrectly rechristened Barrie on the 7:20 programme this evening, was waiting at the lovely Windermere for the drivers who still had a long, long way to go before tea time.
Nick, who gives the orders in this car?
Well, it's an interesting debate. Depends whether we're airborne or not. You see, John's a helicopter pilot, so when we're airborne, he gives the orders, and when we're on the ground, I do. It's an easy split that way.
We heard you had some excitement in Wales.
Well, we had to resort to spectator power in Hafren 2 yesterday. We took and landed on top of a log pile on a very slippery left-hander. And no spectators in the immediate area, and I thought, this is it, we're going to be out. Nick jumped out of the car and screamed at the top of his voice, and you'd never know where they come from, but like lemmings, about 40 people arrived, and they bodily carried the car about 15 metres back onto the track. Nick got his leg in and we were gone.
Sergei, the unique Soviet servicing arrangements, what is the problem?
We have no problem, but it's, we have prophylactic service, only prophylactic.
I see. Now, how are you enjoying the rally?
Very good, but it's a little cold here.
Little cold? You should be used to this. This is like Siberia.
No, from Siberia, this weather same in summer. No much cold.
Oh yeah, it's much harder. It's much slippier in there. I wouldn't have believed it would have been so slidey in there. Just black ice.
But of course, we gave you a big training programme, but you never actually had any ice and snow driving.
No, none at all. just having to take things as they come, that's all.
Well, from Windermere, the cars pushed on into the north of the Lake District, where we had cameras at Coombe and Witham. Coombe is 5.5 miles round the mountains, very steep and very narrow. Witham is 2.5 miles, very narrow and steep. Barrie Gill again.
It was beginning to look as if Marco and Len in the Lancia could do no wrong. Fastest on the Coombe stage and joint quickest at Withup, he extended his lead over Voldegard to 5 minutes 22 seconds. In fact, Bjorn Voldegard was not making any impression on Len. He was 13 seconds down at Coombe and 16 seconds slower at Withup. Anu Mikkola was not only keeping fractionally clear of his teammate Salonen, but he was now chipping away at Voldegard's second place. Salonen was obviously enjoying his duel with Anu Mikkola, faster than the veteran at Coombe, but having to give best at Witham. Juha Kankkonen was really flying in the Toyota, second fastest at Coombe and equaling the leader Allen's time at Witham. The rally isn't, of course, all about the leaders. Every competitor faces his or her particular challenge on this magnificent event, in which to finish is a victory itself. Here comes another Smith and Jones, Trevor Smith and Roger Jones, 31st overall. Suzuki Obar, competing for the 11th time at the Lombard RAC Rally, must have been delighted with his top 20 place in the Mitsubishi. Alan Peacock and Richard Wise had improved the power weight ratio of their Ford by shedding a front bumper. They were in 98th position. Yet another of the squadron of Ford Sierras which have proved such a popular choice for this event. Jeremy Eason, partly sponsored by the Air Force, had reached 94th spot. There's no more cheerful entry than the thalidomide victim Ken Ridley. Known affectionately as the Flying Postman, he was 91st overall. Another rally faithful, Harry Hockley. Despite a puncture and a gearbox change, he was running 41st in his Vauxhall Nova.
Well, as I'm sure plenty of people have told you, the stages are treacherous. I mean, for me to learn the rear-wheel drive again, the car's got so much power and all this sheet ice, it's very difficult. In fact, I've been getting a bit dizzy. I've been spinning so much on the stages that it's a job to keep the car in a straight line, the best way to describe it. I think it's like a wild animal trying to get away from you, and the damn thing keeps biting me all the time as well, you know. So it's quite difficult.
Morning, girls. Now, what have you been doing in the Lake District?
Slipping and sliding off the road, I'm afraid to say. We just came round this corner, it was that icy that we just slid off the road, and the car was parked with all wheels off the ground, so we had to get a lot of people and lift it onto the road, and we lost about 2 minutes, but we're here, safe and sound.
Hello, John.
Hello.
How are you going now in the Skoda?
Oh, not so bad. We have been very lucky with the conditions.
Lucky?
Yes, it's slippery and nice, and that suits this car very well.
And suits you?
Yes, well. Yeah, we are from Scandinavia and we are driving on these sort of roads for 4 months of a year.
Morning. Morning. And how do you like the Lake District then?
I think it's the most beautiful countryside I've ever seen in my life. But it's not so much fun up on the top.
But you got rid of all the ice now. You did very well yesterday.
Got rid of what ice? You've got to be joking. Do you want to come up, jump in the back? I mean, it's the most unbelievable you've ever seen in life. You just arrive at a corner, it's sheet ice. You can see where the cars have all been going, boom, straight in the bank, boom, straight in the bank. You come through and you think, I can't go, and then you go, slide straight into it and have to find first and come out. You can tell whether it's really bad, you can tell by all the crowds, you know. Gus, go, got a rally to do.
Now, the Lombard RAC is full of stories of cars that have been virtually rebuilt on the side of the road, often in the dark, sometimes when the rain has been coming down like stair rods. One car yesterday, for example, had a full piston replacement in just 63 minutes. I wish my local garage would work as fast as that. But over the past 2 days, these behind-the-scenes croons have really performed miracles, as Tony Mason has been finding out.
Now, you might think this is an ordinary common-or garden Peugeot van, but you'd be wrong, because inside here are enough parts, tools and other paraphernalia to make the average small garage envious. It's one of the vast army of service vans that are sent out by the works teams to look after the rally cars. All the parts are kept inside, strapped neatly to the wall, quick release ties so they can be got off at a service point. The steering rack here, that would be changed in about 10 minutes. Gearbox linkage, that would be fitted in about 5 minutes. Even the suspension legs and so on, that could be 5 minutes. And would you believe a gearbox could be changed in just 19 minutes? In the back of the van, there's the all-important generator to provide power and spare body panels that might need replacing. Now, you'll notice how neat and tidy and clean it is in here. It's just like a surgeon's operating theatre. Everything's got its own little place. All the nuts and bolts and bits and pieces all have their own compartments. And as well as looking after the cars, the mechanics have to feed and water their drivers. And would you believe that even the teaspoons have their own little holder? And this particular beverage has another use, because in the event of oil getting in the clutch, this can be poured in and it flushes it out.
Well, those service crews are about to come into their own, because that brings us to mid-afternoon and the lead cars are about to tackle the five long stages in the giant Kielder Forest. Four in the dark, all of them very icy. Alena Dow bit up a lead of 5.5 minutes. Valdegaard was fighting off the twin challenge of Mikkola and Salonen. We pick up the story at Kershope. 10.35 miles of narrow, twisting gravel and mud and ice. Barrie Gill.
There was quite a contrast between the parkland stage of Lowther and the Kershope Forest section, which had needed snow ploughs to clear it. For once, Vatanen was not the fastest, and his lead was cut to 3 minutes. It was Hannu Mikkola who was now Alain's closest challenger. Second fastest at the Kershope stage, Mikkola jumped up the leaderboard to second spot. Juha Kankkonen had not given up hopes of victory in the Toyota. The twice world champion was fastest at Lowther and fourth fastest at Kershope. This snowy stage was not kind to Bjørn Voldegard. He put his Toyota off the road and lost nearly 2 minutes before he was able to finish the stage. Sadly, back in fifth place. The first non-Scandinavian on the leaderboard is still Germany's Armin Schwartz, a brilliant third fastest in his Audi at Kershope. It promoted him past Bente Auricola to sixth place. Auricola was continuing to have a luckless day in his privateer Lancia. He had a puncture here, losing a minute on the leaders. This grim stage was also a fierce test for Ari Vatanen. He had to drive 10 miles without the benefit of a clutch, but still clocked fourth fastest time. The top Briton Malcolm Wilson not only had a spin here, but unkind spectators even threw snowballs at him. Despite that, he managed 13th fastest time and ended the stage in 11th place. Even the Finns are full of praise for the driving of this man in the two-wheel drive car. Fastest through this stage, David Llewellyn was still bravely battling with a Ford that has too much power for its two-wheel drive in these conditions. He was 15th overall. Michael Eriksson's younger brother Martin in 24th place in his Audi. Sadly, Kershope was to see the end of Louise Aitken Walker's brave drive, and Equally sadly, our in-car camera saw it all.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go!
The daunting keel of the stages lived up to their fearsome reputation yet again. In fact, there were so many changes on the leaderboard that people began to wonder what on earth was happening out there. The man who suffered most was the rally leader, Marco Allen. His 5-minute lead melted away as he first struck gearbox trouble and then was reported to have a puncture on the final stage. It was the chance Juha Kankkonen had been waiting for. First he split the masters of Mikkola and Salonen and then set about the task of regaining the lead that he'd lost on Tuesday. Timo Salonen was one of a host of drivers who came off in the middle of Kielder. It lost him third place, and he only continued with the help of enthusiastic and strong-armed spectators. Ari Vatanen was plagued with even more mechanical problems on the Mitsubishi. After fighting with an impotent clutch, he lost his starter motor as well. And the sad news for British fans is that David Llewellyn lost his unequal struggle with the Kielder Forest, and his rally ended early this evening. Kielder had done its very worst, and remember, the rally is only halfway over.
Oh, you've had a hectic time in Kielder. What's happened?
Well, you know, in starting immediately, I coming in Kielder, you know, in our gearbox is broken in third gear, taking big noisy, and our mechanics takes fantastic job. He chased something half an hour, but I pay road penalty about 1:20, and after in too many cars.
So that's dropped you down now. You've lost about.
Yeah, and you know, it's really, really slippery. I come in, maybe I am 13 or 14 car in road. And after, you know, I have in last state also in puncture and really, really bad luck. You know, it's, I come in very, what I say, safety in Kielder and not worry. But now in, maybe Juha is leading. I don't know exactly what the situation, but okay, still 2 days. Tomorrow is really rally start.
How did you like Kielder, Juha?
Terrible. I mean, there's not really, okay, it's the same for everybody, but still there's no driving feeling or something like that because it's so slippery and just hitting all the time the banks, and it's not nice when the weather is like that. It's much nicer when you have good competition.
You seem to have been putting in quite a charge. You're climbing up rapidly.
Yeah, it has gone well today. No problems or nothing. We finally got the car ready this morning. No, it has been good day for us.
Now, you're the local man, the Cumbrian in the Kielder Forest. What's it been like?
Absolutely treacherous. Never before have I ever seen anything like that. Must have had more spins and etc. in there than probably I've had since I started driving this car. It's incredible. It's crazy.
Well, 3 days down, 2 to go. The cars are still pulling into the Parc Fermé in Carlisle. It's still freezing. And really, ice has been the great leveller today. Look how it's transformed the leaderboard. Juha Kankkonen back in the lead, head-to-head with the old fox, Hannu Mikkola, and just 15 seconds ahead of Marco Allen. So now it goes Toyota, Mazda, Lancia, Toyota, Mazda. What a setup for tomorrow. We'll be back tomorrow, BBC One, daytime live, again on BBC Two at 7:40 p.m. and 11:20. But let's leave you with Australian Ross Dunkerton's view, last view, of this rally. See you tomorrow. Good night.
Go on, not too bad. Whoa, whoa, go on, yes. Go on in it, bitch, go on, in there. Go on. A 2 left, this is. Left 2 here. Whoops, don't move too much. There we are. Whoa. Better if needed.